Welcome to the land of Angandari, the land of the red grasses, where magic and machines have intersected in wondrous ways, home to adventurers and automatons, where wizards may use spell books or sniper nooks, a place that blurs the line between high fantasy and science fiction just enough to piss off fans of either. My name is Jack Packard. I will be your dungeon master, and with me is Amy Campbell.
That's me! I get to go first! Yes! That's me, hi!
And Casey Wosu.
What's up, guys? That's going to be my accent for this. I'm going to do a really bad Australian accent.
I will hurt you.
We've started a fight already. Also with us is Jesse Galena.
Oh, that's me.
And finally, Yahtzee Croshaw.
Hi.
This adventure begins, as all great adventures do, slowly fading in from black to reveal that you're imprisoned in a moving cart.
Oh, what was I drinking last night?
The uneven rocking and lingering smell of body odor immediately make you uneasy. As your eyes adjust to the low light in this windowless cart, you notice the other passengers around you. Why don't we introduce ourselves? How about for fun, let's everyone roll a d20 and we'll go in initiative order to introduce your characters. All right, the first to wake up, Yahtzee. Please describe your character for everyone.
Well, my character's name is Mortimer Raffles with Everwin Smythe. He usually describes himself as a half-elf, because that's the quickest way of putting it. But he appears to be a mixture of multiple genetics. He wants to live up to the role of a gentleman rogue, flamboyant and charismatic, outfoxing the authorities, pulling cons and heists to fund an itinerant lifestyle. But the moment the chips are down, he will joyously betray everyone around him.
Amy, it looks like you're the next to wake up. Please describe your character.
Oh, wow. This is Dabarella. She is a tabaxi fighter, meaning that she is a cat, but she is no pussy. I really couldn't help myself there.
No. Well done. Well done.
Thank you. Her dreams. She is a strong, strong fighter, but she desperately dreams of conquering the world as a chef, going out adventuring forth into the world in hopes of fame, so that maybe, just maybe, someone will like her enough to come and eat her goddamn food.
I hope one day we may all enjoy your fancy feast.
Thank you.
All right, KC, you're next in the order. Describe your character for us.
My character is a once noble ASMR or ASMR. I don't know. I don't know how you pronounce
ASMR.
It's pronounced ASMR.
ASMR procurer. Sigmar Iceblood is his name. He was once a notoriously problematic son of a prominent family. And he was then outcast and stripped of his titles and wealth as a result. So because of that, he had a very noble upbringing, but he actually despises the rich. He's very much brash in terms of nobility, but is actually kind of posh when considered around commoners, so he's kind of unlikable in that way.
Perfect. And finally, the last to wake up, the groggiest of the brunch. The groggiest of the bunch, the Jesse.
Mimosa's
head start on that.
Yeah.
Cooking, I see.
Serving some good stuff in this prison barge. All right. So Grinderbin is a mushroom folk, so he's a full fungus. So he has a humanoid shape, but his head actually goes up to like a mushroom-like thing, big mushroom cap. No eyes you can specifically see, but he does have a mouth right in the front. He's dressed very fancily. Frilled collar, long purple coat, fringy puffy sleeves. Very posh and fun stuff to be wearing. Grinderbin wants to corner the market on selling discount quirky magic items. But he needs the capital and the contacts in order to do that. And he's very impatient, and adventuring makes great money, he's heard. So that's probably the fastest way to make money and hopefully not die. But that's what, you know, adventuring with people is for.
Is this an old posh adventuring party?
I think it's all posh except for Dabarella. So yeah.
Dabarella doing her own thing.
Grinter been more dress posh than is posh.
Yes. All right. So as you all wake up in this smelly, dark moving cart, looking around, you see in the cart with you a dashing looking goblin with smooth black hair combed to the side. He has a thin, well-groomed mustache that tells you that his confidence outweighs his ability to hide that he's a pervert. Also, in the cart is a man that looks more like a toe with an eye patch. His scowl and one good eye let you know that he thinks toxic masculinity is rad as hell. And so the dashing goblin with the pencil mustache looks at the four of you up and down and goes, "Oh, you're awake, I see. Lovely."
Good look around, be like, I'll make a roll if you want me to, try and get a bearings for where we are, assuming there are windows in this cart.
There are no windows in this cart.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
You're like, sure, where are we, Endo? You know where we're headed?
Well, what I've been able to figure out is that the town doesn't much care for my, let's say, less than dressed ways. So I got picked up last night. I assume you did as well.
Sigmar stares at the goblin threateningly, but doesn't say anything.
Ooh, stare all you want. Charge you $5 if you want to stare longer.
Dabarella turns and says, "Oi, mate! Fuck are we? Where'd you come from? Where did we come from, though?"
Yeah, where were we up to now?
Oh, I got picked up in Landonford, just a couple miles down the way. I assume you guys got picked up as well. We're here in the Broken Kingdom. I don't know what else you want of me, but stop yelling, I guess.
Right.
I didn't put you in here. I'm in here as well. This feels unnecessary.
He's a perv. He'll get what he gets.
And I might like it.
All right, I'm gonna take a sneaky look around and see what the potential exits are.
Okay, go ahead and make me an investigation check.
Ooh, natural 20.
Fucking fuck!
I'm that good.
Well, bullshit. Then you can tell with precise accuracy that this wagon that you are in has exactly one exit, and it is very much locked, and you don't have any of your equipment on you.
By what manner is it locked?
It appears to be two large metal doors. I'll say, like, maybe you push on it a little bit. You try to get, like, a gap within the doors. It seems to be kind of, barred from the other side.
Hmm. Anyone else feeling like flinging themselves out of the back of this thing?
Are we missing literally all of our equipment?
You are missing literally all of your equipment.
Well, there's six of us, including a toe. Why don't we just all press up against this door?
The toe turns to you and says, "Hey, I tried flinging myself against that. It's bolted tight. You didn't think I would try that?" And he flexes a little bit. He's like, "Oh, I tried it so many times. I got a concussion. Yeah, I do. Fuck yeah."
Does he like that he has a concussion?
Oh, yeah, because I think pain is cool. I'm not going to cry about it.
Well, he's been concussed once. Another one wouldn't hurt. What if we all pick up the toe man and use him as a battering ram?
What say you,
Dabarella? No, Dabarella interjects before Toe Man may speak and says, No, use me instead. I'm really strong." She's not very smart.
Well, I'm easy.
Yeah.
Anyone else volunteering for the battering ram position?
Yeah, you, sir. I don't want a bunch of dudes touching me.
All right, cat lady, grab the toe and away you go, I suppose.
Wait, is Dabarella picking up the toe and using toe as weapon, or are other people picking up Dabarella?
Yeah, I think we're picking up Dabarella, right?
Yeah, I think we should all pick up Dabarella and combine our strength to... that should be enough to break the deadbolt.
Mm. Yeah.
But
not really,
is it worth the shot?
Proficient on picking up.
On the condition of we go footways.
Oh,
valid.
She'll throw a little kick in at the end, I guess. It makes sense.
Yeah.
She's not so dumb after all.
Why don't you two pick her up and I'll guide you where to slam.
And try to find the weakest part of this door.
Is that a thing I can check for with my insights?
If you would like to give an insight check on how well this will work, I'll allow that.
Sure. Yeah, let's go with that.
Sure.
Hey.
Hey.
Okay, nice. You are rolling very well. You take a little moment here and kind of inspect the door. Maybe you inspect Dabarella's head. Sigmar, and you do not think this will work. Whether you say anything to everyone else is completely up to you, but you do not think this is going to work very well.
After Sigmar's investigation, he says to everyone else, listen, guys, I think this is a terrible plan.
Well, nothing ventured, nothing gained. It's worth a try.
Unless you want to gain a concussion, like our friend here, I would suggest we think of something else.
Well, I think it's her choice.
Dabarella! On second thought, turns to the mustached man and says, Oi, you never said if you tried nothing, what'd you do? Have you tried anything yet?
First of all, I don't appreciate being talked to in that manner. I have a name. I'm not just Oi. My name is Jeremy Goodsex. And I will tell you that I have tried many times to talk to the guards, to sweet talk my way out of here, as that is my expertise, and it did not work.
All right.
I was able to find somewhere on my body some greasy substances, and I tried to grease the doors open, and it did not work.
All right. Well, if we're in a cart and the doors are on one side, presumably the people driving the cart are on the beyond the wall on the other side. Yes.
I pretty.
That's the reason.
Fair assessment.
So perhaps this calls for a little gentleman thief style deception.
Ooh. Ooh.
Which is my biggest skill by a long way. So I'm gonna bang on the wall where the riders are and go, quickly, someone's dying of a hideous disease.
Sure, give me a deception check.
18.
Ooh. How the fuck are you guys rolling so well already?
I'm afraid to roll.
Sorry, I
feel like I'm gonna bring the average way down.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So you hear from the front of the car, like, horrible disease. Which one?
The ugly one.
The no, I meant which disease?
Oh. Same applies, I suppose.
All right. Well, that's all right. We're here anyway. I'll get the cleanser. The cart slows to a stop, and all of the sudden, in a quite flurry of bright light and grabby hands, you are all manhandled out of the cart and taken to a little clearing. Pew, 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 pew. Scene change.
Send them down.
Scene change. So there is one guard who is investigating back there that disease, and it's just like, oh, we're going to have to clean out this whole place, ain't we? Oh, disease is got in the cart again. Jeremy, I told you diseases were getting the cart. You picked up that good sex fella.
No, Jeremy was the other guard, but that was also good sex's first name.
It's a common name. Enough out of you. I do apologize for my accent. Yes, it is embarrassing. All right.
That's what makes it so fun.
You,
I love it.
Oh, great. No, that's fantastic. So you're all herded out of the cart, and you find yourself in a grassy clearing near a rocky ridge. You are surrounded by guards and archers when you notice a well-dressed noblewoman stepping out in front of her personal bodyguards. Why doesn't everyone give me a history check, and we'll see whether or not you know who this well-dressed woman is. Right off the bat, Dabarella, you're not even sure she is a person. That could be a ghost for all you know.
I nearly went for history. This is bullshit.
But Grinderbin and Mortimer, you would know this person. This is the Viscountess of the land, Lady January Farfel. Kind of a minor nobility, has certain sway within the area. And she steps out in front of her guards, and she says, "Thank you so much for volunteering on this magical acquisition quest."
Ooh, Grinderbin will do a little bow curtsy sort of hybrid thing, and be like, "Lady January."
And she looks expectantly to everyone else.
Other people be like, do this thing, like Sigmar, this awkward motion that I'm doing.
Sigmar stares at her with contempt.
Dabarella attempts to bow, but kind of falls over a little bit. She doesn't really know what's going on. She doesn't really know what she's doing. She doesn't really know there's a person there.
That was quite a deep bow. Floor bow.
I'll immediately try to push my way to the front of our little grouping and say, "This has all been a complete mistake. You have completely the wrong person. I'm actually a glazier."
Ooh, what's a glazier?
It's someone who fixes windows.
Oh.
Yes, I have a little shop back in whatever that town was.
Oh, you do? Yes, wonderful.
I was going to a fancy dress party as a gentleman thief. And some sort of terrible roustabout seems to have accidentally vomited all down my front.
Oh,
I can see why you've got some kind of confusion here. So now that we've got this all cleared up, I will just be on my way and subtly point to the side.
Because you did such a great job describing what you currently look like, I'm going to need a deception check, but with disadvantage, which means you roll two deception checks and we take the lower of the numbers.
16.
Still a very high deception.
Oh, the other one was a 6?
9.
It's 9, but Mortimer has +7 to deception. Oh, okay. So
I'm very deceptive.
Very, very deceptive. And so she buys that you are indeed the window fixer. And she says, Well, I am so glad that you're here, because I've been meaning to tell you, you never came to fix my windows."
Well, I'd need to check my ledger for my current list of clients, but I'm sure that was all my secretary's fault.
Of course it was. And once you're done on our little acquisition quest, you can get right back to my windows. I'll make sure of it. And she looks to her two bodyguards. "We'll make sure that he gets back to the windows, right?" You see two guys, big strong guys nodding. Yep. Uh-huh.
Look, I really think a magical acquisition quest is sort of outside of my skill set.
Well, I don't know.
If there happen to be any windows at this magical place, then I'm your man, obviously. But otherwise, I should probably just stay at the guard.
And while that's very fair, I wouldn't go down there. That's what I have you workers for. Our involuntary workers. That's what we call them. You go on, you go get the magical items. If you can bring it back to me, you get to get off of work. How wonderful.
I think I'm on a hiding to nothing here, everyone.
Oh, magic items.
That's right. And you see the toe man speaks up and says, "Listen here, I don't care about any of these highfalutin antics. I don't care about your magical items, your quests. I don't care about you. My name's Tourniquet Fast Level, and I say..." Oh, you probably just heard a bunch of dice roll. All right. Seven arrows enter his body, and Tourniquet Fast Level dies on the spot. And she goes,
"I'm going to look over at January and be like,
so about our equipment stipend for this magical item retrieval."
"Oh, of course. Once we lovingly place you down the hole over there, we'll throw all your items to you." And she points towards the rocky ridge over there, and over there what you see is some dead vines and roots branching out of a black void. There seems to be a very deep hole in the middle of all of these evil looking roots.
Cool. Grinderbin's gonna, like, we have some space between us, not going to approach her. I don't want to get shot. But be like,
"Hope you remember how much this faith that we put in you for this, man."
And like do another little gesture and aim towards the hole, but wait for official instructions to start walking.
"Ooh, there's a good lad. There's a good lad."
Sigmar moves... or wants to move near the edge of the hole.
Okay.
He wants to say to January, "Once this is done, I will kill you," before jumping into the hole.
Hold on. Let me see if she knows which equipment is yours. Great. So Sigmar basically says F you and jumps down the hole.
"What exactly are we looking for?"
That's the loveliest thing about magical acquisitions, is we just know this is a place of power. She pulls out like one of those divining rod things. She's like, "I know there's magic under there, but I'm not going down into the dirt. So you bring back a powerful magical item, I believe. Where's it? What? She's like looking to her. She's looking to her big bodyguard. He's like, "What? Was it a scroll of some kind?"
"Scroll, madam."
"Yeah, it was a scroll of some kind. It was a scroll of necromancy, madam. A scroll of necromancy, I believe it's what it was called."
Okay, lady. Since you've already found the hole, you probably won't be needing that divining rod, and it would certainly be helpful to us down there. Perhaps we could take a deposit. We could leave this good sex person with you.
"Ooh, I like him."
Well, he's for sale, you know.
give me a charisma check here. Let's see if you can talk your way into the magical divining rod. An 11. She says, "Well, I'll keep Mr. What was your name again? Good Sex. I'll keep Mr. Good Sex company, but I'm afraid." And she sticks it down. She has an enormous chest, and so she sticks it in between her two breasts, just because that's what I did physically. So I need to explain why I just did that when she put it down. And so she hides it in her bosom. And she says, "But you'll have to do without it. Good luck down there."
Okay. Well, I guess I will head for the hole. But before that, I will just whisper an aside to Mr. Goodsex, saying, "If you get that divining rod and chuck it down the hole at any point in the next few minutes, then I'm pretty sure she'll be into that."
I'll magic fingers away.
"Good man," and give him a little tap on the shoulder, and then head for the hole.
All right. You all head for the hole, and what a lovely hole it is. As you get closer, you see the darkness in the center kind of parts, and you can see some very simple wooden stairs spiraling down.
Oh, so I jumped and I could have taken the stairs is what you're saying.
You could have taken the stairs, absolutely.
Just flung down the flight of stairs.
I'm very happy though, that you jumped. We're just going to say you're dexterous enough to land without rolling an ankle.
That was the hope.
All right, down the hole. Pew, 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 pew. You come into this circular room. And you see, once you're down here, giant metal framed doors with deep wooden planks that seal off something you can hear right now, which is an audible grinding noise coming from the other side of the doors. Huh. All around this antechamber lie the bones of long dead treasure hunters. You see statues of scholars and fallen, crumbling pillars that litter the circumference of the room.
All right. Who wants to open the door?
We're going to need our equipment first.
Yeah, are we able to yell up out of the hole? Can they hear us from down there?
yeah, go ahead. Absolutely.
Give me my shit, bitch!
Yes, we can tell you're from a noble family.
All right. Right as you're saying that, actually, right before you say that, items start to fall. And you just hear it go,
"Dad, what? Do we know which stuff is his stuff? Because I don't want to give it. Oh, we just fucking throw it all down. Fuck it." Fuck.
And then you hear Jeremy Goodsex saying, "Don't worry, your back looks naughty. Let me work on that."
It's fun to think we can't rely on Jeremy Goodsex.
Hold on, Jeremy Goodsex needs to make a charisma roll. Oh, she does not like that back rub. Get off of me. So he's not doing a good job of getting that divining rod for you. So items drop down. You now have all of your items.
All right.
You're in this room.
Sweet.
Dabarella looks around and notices the skeletons. As she is a prolific fighter in her own regard, it occurs to her that something has to have done these people off. And she wonders out loud, "Hi, yo. Yo, anyone, what do you reckon happened to these fellas?"
Well, I suppose we could examine the corpse.
Definitely what I want to do.
Examine the nearest corpse, like this one here.
I'll examine a different corpse.
Sure, why not? Everyone, if you would like to look at corpses, give me an investigation.
And I'll go kick... I'm going to go kick its body.
You're going to kick the bones of the body.
And then I'll do an investigation check.
I think that is lovely.
Investigation.
13 investigation.
11.
7.
Oh, I am lagging.
Oh, hey.
Oh,
dang. Yay!
Ooh.
Nice.
Dabarella, what you clearly notice, Mortimer, you have some ideas here as well, is all of their bones, until Dabarella kicked them, of course, were pretty intact. And you take a look at the armor, and the armor looks really intact. It looks like some of the shields are busted up, but they also just look very old. It almost looks like they died... possibly, like, it doesn't look like they did not die of any physical wounds.
Huh. So what does that leave? It leaves gas, perhaps?
Starvation.
Or starvation. But they've got broken shields, though.
Mm-hmm. Did they fight each other?
Well, the bodies would be damaged if they'd fought.
Yeah, and once again, it looks like the shields are like old and rotted.
Okay, so they just naturally damaged.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm. So then
Dabarella looks at the corpses and says, they didn't fight shit. I don't know how they died.
Yeah, why'd they
just to make sure everyone knows.
Right. But why would they die of starvation if the stairwell leading up is right there?
I know, that lady person seemed like a bit of a bitch. I don't know, maybe she closed the hole.
I don't know why I share my insights with you people.
Can I do an insight check on the doors or whatever check I need to do on the doors?
Yeah, if you want to, like, investigation on the doors.
So investigation check?
Yeah, if you want to take a look at the doors.
I'm not the best investigator, I guess. But that's 12.
That's a flat 12. That's pretty good. I'm going to say with a 12, you notice, like, they are large and sturdy. They have a very simple kind of grab handle, no doorknob, and there doesn't appear to be any keyhole. You do get closer to the door, though, that, like, whirring, grinding noise, there is something on the other side of these doors.
But they're unlocked.
It appears as if they are unlocked.
I want to do a quick investigation of the statue I'm near.
Absolutely.
It seems
ahead.
Like there's a body near each one of those. So investigation?
Investigate that statue all you want.
I got 11. 11.
All right. With an 11, you don't know who this is a statue of. It appears to be a robed person. They're holding a stone book. Everything seems to be firmly in place as far as, like, the book is concerned. It just looks like a kind of a general, like, statue of someone who's scholarly.
Okay. Does the statue move at all if I, like, give it a gentle prod or try to rotate it?
Give me a strength check.
Actually, Tabarella, do you want to have a go?
Oh, people don't normally ask me to do things. I'd really like that, mister. Sure.
Be my guest. I'll just stand and watch from way over here.
Ooh,
boom.
Big
nice.
21. This statue comes cleanly off the base. You are able to lift up the statue with ease. Nothing really happens, but yeah, you pick up the statue, you're able to move it, maybe you do a couple squats, you know, just to show off.
Okay, I was looking for, like, hidden mechanisms or something, but I guess this isn't that kind of dungeon.
Sigmar says to the rest of the group, if you guys are done fooling around, I think this door opens.
Who are you calling a fool?
Well, you're welcome to open it. I'll stay here.
So, Sigmar opens the door.
Don't open it!
I'll watch the six.
He does not listen.
Oh.
Sigmar opens the door, bum, 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 and what you see down a narrow hallway, you see many sets of spinning blades bursting out of the sides of the walls, alternating with frankly ridiculous speed. And so it's just a bunch of blades coming out of the walls, different heights, different speeds, different intensities of blades. Obviously, they're not moving in this picture because I'm limited to the maps I can create. But you have to use your imagination and imagine that this hallway is full of doom and death.
I'm getting that picture.
Great.
Anyone have a monkey wrench?
I've only got my trusty rapier, I'm afraid.
I like monkeys, but I have no wrench.
All right, I'm going to ask for some, like, more details about this room. Do all the whirling death traps, are they all at floor level, or are some of them at the ceiling? Could we potentially climb over them?
They are coming out of the walls. Some of them are very low, and some of them are very high. Okay. There's a bunch of them all at different levels.
Is there any sign of infrastructure machinery, like working gears, that we can possibly see from here?
Ooh, let's see here. Why don't you give me Arcana check?
Arcana check, eh?
An Arcana check.
Not very good.
Not very good at all. You don't know how this works.
Well, Mushroom Lad, you're the artificer. You take a look.
Are we looking to see if there's something at the end to, like, turn it off? Because I'm very agile and I could probably just cartwheel down.
Yeah, I'm dexterity 15. We're all agile. I just rather not lose my limbs.
I'm not cartwheeling through anything. Yeah, what I would like to investigate this because I do like to tinker, and I've got an ability that might help.
Ooh.
Oof. Eesh. Boy, howdy, these are some strange machines.
Yeah, with a 10, you can't see much. Like, they're coming in and out of the wall, so maybe you can see some small gears in there. You with a 10, I'll say, like, you can clearly see there are six blades, giant blades of different sizes and speeds at different heights. But yeah, figuring out how they work is a little tricky for you.
Gonna look over at Dabaril and be like,
so you said you're good at cartwheeling.
Yeah. I cartwheel good, yes.
Right. Well, I guess you're up. I'll just watch from over here.
I'm gonna can I do one last check, I guess? Cause I think I have artificer blood in me as well, right?
You do have artificer blood in you as well, yeah. So
should I try an arcana?
Give me an arcana and then you can, we'll say you can add 2 to it as your proficiency bonus with your artificer nature. Because you're a bit of a gearhead.
Hey, that's more like it.
Oh!
Ooh, a dirty 20. All right. Well, you take a moment as Dabarella is like, doing her stretches, like limbering up. You take a moment, and the thing that you notice about all of these blades is while they're moving very fast, it's actually kind of creating an illusion that they're thicker than they are. They do look to be made of very thin material. And so like that allows them to move very fast, but and with a dirty 20, they might not be the strongest blades in the world.
What do we have that's big and heavy to chuck in there? Maybe
what are we carrying? I've got a crowbar.
The statue. I'm still holding the statue.
Yeah.
Hey, there's a thought.
That's big and heavy.
You are still holding the statue, of course.
Dabarella, with statue above hand, statue above head, looks at her fellows and says, "By golly, I could just chuck this at it."
And who was giving us shit about wasting time with the statues, eh?
Dabarella, if you would like to make an attack roll against the saw, you go right ahead. Oh yeah, so that's like that's a dirty 21 right there. You chuck this statue at these first two blades, and the statue erupts. The blades fly everywhere. Actually, for everyone that's in that hallway.
Oh boy!
If you could give me a
I saw that move. Yes.
Dabarella, did you throw from where you are?
Yep, I yeeted that thing the second I got permission.
Perfect.
And I yelled yeet.
Grinderbin and Sigmar, if you could please give me a dexterity saving throw.
14.
15.
14 and 15. All right. So each of you will only take half of this damage, which means you each take 5 damage from all of these metal shards flying everywhere.
Dang.
But
Dabarella says, "Oops."
All right, good work, team.
So you have 2 out of the 6 whirring saw blades destroyed.
You're gonna have to give us a little more update before you do that again.
Okie dokie.
Well, you should probably grab another statue for the next one.
Yeah, and we'll go ahead and make our way out of this hallway this time. Thanks for that.
Do I need to roll again, or can I just pick up the statues?
Oh yeah, your strength roll will carry over. Yep, absolutely.
So Dabarella picks up the statue, makes her way back.
I'm glad we brought the pussycat.
Damn right.
All right, so Dabarella, you prepare to chuck a statue at the next blades. I'm gonna need another attack roll from you.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, that's still a 12.
That's still a 12. This second statue bounces off of the floor before it reaches the saws and just kind of grinds itself down to powder. The saw blades are still whirring.
All right. Number three.
We got two more statues to try this with.
Yeah.
And then we've got bodies.
Oh, okay, there you go. So that's a 17 total with your strength. So this one bursts the second set of saw blades, but you are now in the hallway, so I'm going to need a dexterity saving throw from you.
Ah, shit.
I'm very, very sorry. Ooh, I'm so very sorry. Woof. You were what you were doing, what I imagine you did is after you threw the statue, you like turned around and looked back to everyone and put your hands on your hips. You know, it's like, look at the good job I did. And now your entire back is full of shrapnel. So you take 8 points of damage.
Oh, damn. Shit.
Man, this adventuring business is dangerous.
Like right from the get go, huh?
Who would have known?
But you did like destroy the saws.
Yes, the second set of straw of saws are now destroyed.
And now it's just rotated knives at the end?
Yes, big long blades.
Feel up to throwing up the fourth statue in there?
Does anyone have anything they could use to help the thingies on my back?
Oh, moan, moan, moan. Right.
Do I have the ability? I have a spell cure wounds.
That can do it. Yeah. So how do you cure wounds? You have to touch Dabarella. So how do you think that you cure her wounds here with your magic?
Since she asked if anyone could help her after taking all the scrapnel, Sigmar just walks up to her. He doesn't really say anything. Touches her on the shoulder and applies the heal.
Great.
That works.
Is there maybe like a look of pity or like?
No, this is more like kind of ambivalence.
Oh, okay. So then Dabarella, you feel like as Sigmar places his hand on you, you feel like the metal scraps on your back fall out and your wounds like close up like Wolverine, and you get 7. You took 8 damage and you get 7 back.
And then he finally says to her, "One more time."
All right, if we stopped complaining, chop chop. There's one too many statues in this room.
Before grabbing the final statue, Dabarella looks at Sigmar and goes for a very awkward hug as thank you. Before marching her way to the statue, having now learned her lesson, stands outside of the hall.
Smart.
And rolls the final attack.
Destroy.
Damn.
Nice.
Boom!
Holy cow, you are rolling hot today. Absolutely. The final statue hurls gracefully through the hallway, landing precisely at the point in which the blades were most weak, sending metal shards everywhere. You can still hear whirring contraptions within the wall, but the hallway does look safe.
All right.
Ooh, it sounds like go in the hallway.
Check this out.
Yeah, after you, man. In fact, after everything. Are you coming, Dabarella? Oh, yeah, off you go.
All Ooh, right. Coming up.
Here I come, fast as I can.
Bringing up the rear.
Yeah, you guys go first, no worries. All right, as you make your way into this room, the first noticeable thing you see is a long dead skeleton of a giant beast. The second is that you notice that the door is impatiently waiting for you to notice it. As you turn away from the giant beast skeleton, what you see is my very best Photoshop work. What you see is a giant wooden door with a face on it. It's a magical door.
Do not want.
And he says, oh, I see we have company.
Okay. Now, obviously, I'm a master of deception and persuasion and intimidation, all that. Mm-hmm. But can I get some kind of initial assessment of this person? With my kind of insight check.
That would be lovely. An insight check would be lovely.
To try to see what sort of method of manipulation would be the best approach. The normal insight check, 18.
Boom. Well, so that's a 21. So yeah, your insight into the situation is usually with magically imbued items. They have a very specific purpose. What you can tell about him, or about the door, is that the door was kind of like eager for you to notice it. It was like, oh, hello. Oh, you know, like it didn't want to say anything, but like now that you did notice it, it was like, finally, I can talk. Hello. Eager.
Yeah, understand. And he's, I will say, my goodness, what a magnificent door.
Why, thank you. Yes, I'm feeling a little old nowadays, but I've still got it where it counts.
And very impressive.
Assuming that's the hinges, Sigmar says.
He looks at you, Sigmar, and is just like, you know it.
And very impressively enchanted, if I must say. So, what's on the other side of you?
Well, because you're such a gentleman, I can tell. I'll let you know that I've been tasked with keeping this door closed so the two people inside can't get out. They're a bunch of troublemakers.
Who was it that enchanted you, just out of interest?
Oh, the very famous wizard, Nizback Picklefeather.
Yeah, you were prepared for that answer.
Know I was. That's a name I had written down and everything. I didn't.
Proceeds to write it down.
Yes, Nizback, with an N, Nizback Picklefeather. And a lovely magician.
How long have you been keeping those troublemakers of yours in there?
Oh, that is a great question. Although I will say my sense of time down here is a little fuzzy. What I can tell you is that, see those bones over there? That used to be a creature. He would, you know, be here in case anyone tried to get in before they got to me, and he's long dead. So I've been here for quite some time, at least one creature life.
There's a reason you think the people in there are still going to cause trouble if you open the door.
Well, I don't have that kind of reasoning. I'm a magical door. Come on. It's my job to keep the door closed. That's what I am supposed to do.
Right. Excuse me. I just need to confer with my trap and statue removal specialists that I travel with. What do we think?
Is that me?
I'm just asking the party generally.
Like, Sigmar wants to know the morality of destroying an enchanted door.
But an enchanted door could be a good ally to have.
Well, they don't move around much.
Are you suggesting we take it with us?
Well, the cat's carrying it.
I like this plan.
Okay.
How enchanted of a door could it be? Like, why wouldn't we be able to just pull it open if it's this friendly with us?
Well, it said it was enchanted. It told us it was enchanted with the express purpose of keeping closed and keeping
for the people inside. But what about us opening it from the outside?
Well, there's a thought.
Like a security door.
I'll turn to the door and say, would it be possible, to get a better look at the troublemakers you describe without you having to open and let them out?
You mean you want to go in?
Well, not necessarily. I was just wondering if maybe we could open it just a little crack.
Oh, like I could sneak you a peek. You are cheeky. I love it. I just love it. Like open my hinges a little bit.
I think I'm in here.
You were very nice right away. I wasn't expecting that. What I will tell you is this. I have been imbued with such knowledge that my maker, Nizbak Picklefeather, knew that the only one to open the door could be them. So, because you've been so kind to me, I will let you know the only way I open is if you ask me a riddle that I cannot answer.
Oh, this
but be warned, I know everything.
Okay.
So we get to ask the riddle.
That's right, and if I can't answer it, I open
can
up.
Can Debrella ask? Debrella looks at the door and with the biggest smile and hands on hips looks and says, how many yeets could a yeetster yeet if a yeetster could yeet yeet?
Oh, well, it might confuse it, dear.
Such an innocent child. Debrella was it. A yeetster could not yeet a yeet, as the very act of yeeting, it would cancel out the motion of the first yeet. Next.
Abrella sits down and ponders, looking at the bones of the beast.
Was that strictly solving the riddle? I feel there should be some appeals process.
For you, maybe.
I'd have to understand the riddle before I understood if that was a good answer.
We're talking basic counter movement physics here when applying that to yeeting or pushing. Get on the trolley.
All right, anyone else want to go?
Honestly.
Yeah, I can do one, but.
No, go right ahead.
Oh, okay.
So, you prefer a bit of a riddle, do you?
It's what I've been programmed to do.
So, what's in this room with you right now that's not of this world?
I love the riddle, but unfortunately, I know it's a trick question. You see, I'm not in the room.
Ooh, that wasn't even my answer, but I do like it.
I love being correct.
What about a game of... Do you like 20 questions?
Oh,
ooh,
no.
What kind of riddle is that?
It's a, one of those active riddles.
Ooh, a new kind of riddle. Why... That would fill me with such joy. It's very boring down here.
We have that kind of time.
We could lower it to like 5. if you truly are as smart as you say you are.
Ooh, I like a challenge. I'll tell you what. I'll give you that 5. If I can't get it in 5, oof, I'll open right up for you. Okay. Am I an animal?
No.
Ooh. Am I a mineral?
No.
Ooh.
Am I a ghost?
That was going to be my question. You be quiet now. This is me playing the game. Am I paranormal?
No.
Ooh, I love not knowing things. Okay, I'm not an animal. I'm not paranormal. I'm not a mineral. I know it. I know it right now. I'm the wind.
Good guess, but still no.
Ooh, what am I?
Well, you got one guess left because I only counted four.
Oh, fuck. I'm very smart, just not good at counting. Oh, that's I know. Fair. I'm me, a magical door.
I really liked your enthusiasm, but still incorrect.
You all hear like a very subtle like click click, like he unlocked himself.
Okay, someone open it.
Well, I'm going to use Mage Hand and open the door.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Cool. And I'll open and like kind of keep eye contact with the door.
Sure. I'll just stand behind the
cage. So yeah, you use your mage, stand behind the cage. You use your mage hand and he goes, "Ooh, I feel something shivery on me. Now, of course." And yeah, he opens himself up a little bit.
And you can
see a bit of the room behind him.
Sigmar does an insight check from what he can see inside.
Something looks very odd to you right from the get-go. It looks like a bedroom. you very clearly see like a bed, a rug, a nice working desk. This looks like someone lives here.
Well, we knew someone was being held prisoner here.
Yeah, can I see who's inside?
Not right where you are. You cannot.
Because of my insight check or because of where I'm physically standing?
Because of where you're physically standing. From your insight check, you can, based off of what you can see, this is a humanoid creature. You can tell it has, you know, like a medium-sized creature, which is like general human size. All of you are medium-sized, I believe. Unless, are mushroom folks smaller?
I just went with medium.
Oh, okay, yeah. So yeah, you can tell it's like a medium-sized creature inside. And he's like, "Okay, I've opened up. Now tell me what I was."
You're like, "A fungus."
Wait, hold on. Before, oh crap, did you give the answer already?
A fungus, of course.
You know, now that you're open and not doing the thing you got, you know, I could really use a magical door if you wanted to come with.
What?
Are we doing this?
You mean leave the cave?
Well, you've served your purpose.
I suppose I have. I could learn so much about the world. Yes! Before you leave, if you could get the hinges off, I'd love to see the outside.
Oh, I've got the right tool for that.
Oh, jolly good.
All right, while you mess around with that, I'm going to head on inside.
Okay.
Right. if that's okay with you, Dory? I don't know what we're calling
Dory?
You.
Dory!
Dory! We've found Dory!
Dory the Explorer.
You see the old face on the door, like, get a little weepy and goes, "My master did not give me a name. I will accept Dory."
Oh, congratulations. Oh. Now we have a door named Dory.
I feel alive!
Well, that's awesome. What's going on back here?
Lead the way.
Casey's done with the riddles.
Lead the way.
Hold on. I need to make a note that the door is called Dory now.
Dory and needs to be added to the inventory.
Yeah, it'll take you a little bit to get Dory off. So do you want to spend your time getting Dory off?
Yeah, I can work on Dory.
Okay.
So chat up Dory.
So for the three of you that go into the room, let me describe what you see. You come into what looks to be a bedroom. You see a fancy purple rug and a matching bed spread next to it. What appears to be a working desk across the room. You notice another bedroom, almost mirrored, but donned in green. There are two well-dressed kobolds arguing in the center of the room. And right when you enter the room, you catch some of that argument, which is, "Clearly, you're on my side of the room." And the other kobold says, "I was not on your side of the room. The line is very clear that I'm on my side of the room. I saw you over on my side of the room earlier this evening, and you've been there before. I know it was you. You're there when I sleep sometimes, and I don't appreciate it. Listen, I'm not on your side of the room. I'm on my side of the room. We've agreed to stay on our own sides." Okay. And they're arguing. They have not noticed that you've entered.
Okay. I'm going to boldly stride forwards and say, "Dungeon inspection."
They turn around.
And an inspection. Excuse me, we've been waiting for several minutes.
Give me a persuasion check.
No problem. I have persuasion plus 5. 18.
Fuck bam. You!
Okay. As you can see, this is our dungeon.
Yes, this is our dungeon. What do you need to see? The water's over there, our desks. Everything should be in order. Oh, God.
We're not interested in any desks. I and my colleagues represent the local Magical Artifacts Association. We're doing a standard dungeon inspection. You should have been sent the letter 2 weeks ago. Now, get your magical artifacts out and ready for inspection, please. We are on a schedule.
For magical objects,
and you see both of them, they're gonna move together just because it's easier for me to move two things at once. So it might look weird. Both of them rush to their desks, and they start. They seem to have a lot of tinkering items here, both mechanical and potion based in nature. They start holding up vials, is this one? I got this. Holding up what appears to be a little grenade, a little half built automaton. What do you need to see?
Well, what do you need to see? Well, it's going on?
Yes, everything. Just lay it all out.
Oh, okay, yeah. So they very clearly lay out a bunch of wondrous items, potions and mechanical bits.
Okay, I'll do a check. Can I make some kind of inside check on what's the most valuable magical artifacts they've got?
Absolutely.
Oh, not very good.
Not very good. So are you specifically looking for that scroll, or
yeah, I'm looking for whatever that lady wanted us to get.
The scroll of necromancy. With that insight, there's no scrolls in front of you, and yeah, you would have no idea.
What about scrolls? I will say.
That's what you say.
What about scrolls? You wouldn't happen to be trying to hide any magical scrolls from the inspection committee, would you?
I'm going to make a quick dice roll. Well, what you see one of them says is, and he looks over to the open door and he goes, scroll,
wait a minute. We've never had a dungeon inspection before. I know what you're after. You're after the work of my life, the scroll of necromancy.
Bingo. I don't actually say that.
The other one says, that's why we were put down here, was because of the scroll. They didn't want anyone getting their hands on it. They wouldn't send an inspector.
Dabarella throws her hand up and says, who's they? While she smacks the other hand on the piano that she noticed in the corner.
Oh, you just smacked your hand on that piano?
Yes.
Could you make a dexterity saving throw for me? Please?
Oh, no. Okay.
As you ask that question, your hand comes down at the piano, and as it's coming down, you see one of these kobolds, this happy fella right here, all of a sudden goes, no, but it's far too late as the piano explodes. It seemed to be booby-trapped. And you take 7 points of damage.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
I just healed you for those 7 points.
Everyone gets to roll initiative. Oh, and as it turns out, you weren't lying, Yachts. You do get to go first.
Should I use the rapier or the dagger, do you think, everyone?
Daggers are probably better for throat slitting.
But a rapier means you can stand further away.
Well, I'm right next to the guy. But
that's more like poking in the throat versus...
All right, dagger in the throat it is. A 12.
A 12. So you have your dagger out. What I'm going to say is, as it so happens, the explosion happens and knocks this kobold kind of on his heels. So right when you go to stab, you kind of miss because he's not because he's so graceful, but just because he was moving away from the piano exploding.
Oh, God damn it.
And so, unfortunately, you miss.
Okay. Well, KC's a ranger, right? He's long range.
Yeah.
So can I disengage and roll out of KC's way so that he can get a clear line of sight? All right, I'll just roll over here.
Okay, great. You roll over there, and you hear the one with the staff go, "Dave, watch out!" Dabarella, you just exploded that piano. What would you like to do now? And as you explode the piano, what you notice is these two cobalts like get into attack position. We've gone full Matrix slow-mo. You see them reaching for things. It is on.
Do I know who's going to attack next? Like, in this scenario, do we know who's going to attack next?
What you can tell is that the one with the staff seems to be a little quicker on the draw.
Yeah. Okay. Then I would like, apparently I have a light crossbow. I'd love to whip that out and go for a shot on them.
Yes.
Ooh, dang. That's a big 22. Yes. So you whip out your crossbow, let an arrow loose and thunk, thunks right into his shoulder. Let's see here. You are able as a fighter, you actually have what's called an action surge, which means that if you wanted to, you could move and take another action as a fighter.
Oh. Well, I move closer to the door just to help. And I'm going to go again on that crossbow because I've still got it out.
And unfortunately, you get a little too excited. Maybe like you do a cool like backhand spring to be like, all right, I got this. And your second shot goes wide, sticks into the wall. Which brings us to this cobalt, and he goes, ouch, I do not like that. First thing he is going to do, Amy, is he is going to whip out a little blowgun. And shoot a dart at you. Okay, and what happens is you are easily able to dodge out of the way of that blow dart.
Oh God, I never was good at those things.
So he whips out a dagger, and then throws a dagger at you, Amy, just because you were the one that just attacked him. And once again, it misses.
It's been a while since I've been in an actual fight. I'm good at butterfingers.
And what he is going to do is move away, is move kind of over here to his little desk area, and he's going to start grabbing at stuff. Which brings us to KC. What would you like to do?
From the stuff in the room is actually in the room, right? Can I move to that chair for cover?
Sure. Yeah. If you want to like get behind the chair so you have a little bit of cover.
Okay. So I'll move behind the chair and aim at the other cobalt, Trapsmith. Yeah.
Unsurprisingly, a 22 very much hits this cobalt. So now roll your damage.
Nice.
10. Oh, ouchie. Yes, your arrow sinks deep into the thigh of this cobalt.
Oh, God, this is not fun or worth it, says his brother, because that's not his voice.
And he goes, thanks, brother, for feeling my pain for me. Weird that you said ouch when I got hit. But all right, so that brings us to Grinderman. Grinderman, you're outside. You hear a ruckus on the inside.
Yeah, there was an explosion.
There was an explosion and metal bouncing off of walls. Mm. What would you like to do now that you're outside?
How am I on the... I guess I'd probably be here if I'm doing that. How am I on the getting the hinges Have I gotten this door off yet?
It's probably like there was a little bit of back and forth in there. So I'm going to say it's been a minute or two. You were able to get one hinge off.
Grinderbird is far more worried about being locked in this room. So he's going to send his little buddy out.
Oh, you have a little buddy.
Yeah, he's like, this little thing sometimes works. And he's going to pull a little like contraption with like three little legs on it and set it on the ground. So I'm going to put down my Eldritch Cannon.
Oh my, okay.
I guess I'm going to go for the closer kobold in red.
Okay.
I have to make a ranged spell attack on it.
All right. Do it, I dare you.
Oh, man. Three damage.
Three damage.
And what an amazing... let me make sure I don't have a secondary effect on that. And is pushed 5 feet away from the turret.
Okay, so you kind of like blow this cobalt into the desk area. It's just like, I mean, it's a pretty sweet cannon, but I mean, kind of weak. Maybe we could talk shop later and I can help you, or I'll take it and fix it up. Don't worry, I'll take it and fix it up.
Sorry, it was in t-shirt shooting mode, I guess.
And this cobalt sees the cannon placed right next to Dabarella and is going to throw something.
Oh no. Oh, and Grinderbin will keep working on this door for now.
Priorities.
All right. Everyone within this circle that I just placed, please make me a dexterity saving throw. So this cobalt, pulls out, like a specialized bag. It has like ropes tied around it, maybe some bark on the outside. Throws that in your general direction, explodes, is able to, your cannon is able to kind of like hop and dodge out of the way. But Dabarella, you take 15 damage.
Jeez.
Shit.
And the cannon takes 7.
Okay.
I'm on 9 health. What happens if it hits 0?
Then we do something fun called death saving throws. It's fun, I swear.
I'll just die.
That is this kobold's turn. Actually, you know what? He's going to spend a little bit of his movement to get up, and he is going to move away from where he was. That brings us back to Mortimer. What would you like to do?
Well, I'm thinking I should be trying to hide for a sneak attack, and I'm right next to these desks. So I want to see if I can hide under the desks and sort of slowly crawl my way through. 11.
This one closest to you still sees you. This one over here does not see you.
Okay. I think I should just run up and attack the kobold alchemist.
Okay.
Yeah, so just sort of rush him.
All right, you hop on the desk, hop over the other desk. You are now right above this alchemist. What do you do?
Well, I'm going to stab him with my rapier this time.
Great.
14.
With your rapier, you go to stab and he blocks it with his staff.
Shit.
So that's just the end of that? Like,
that's just the end of that one. Yep.
I'm just L. Flinning over here with this guy.
Yep. Amy, that brings us back around to Dabarella.
Do I have enough movement to be able to reach the thing, or like to the?
Yeah, you
run
could
without
actually,
the staff.
You could get to either of them. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Well, I make my way to the trap smith.
Okay.
And I would like to attack them. I'd like to smack them with my club.
Sure. Could you just do me one quick favor? And again,
yes.
I'm so, so sorry. Oh, is God. If you could just show me the exact path you took to get to the cobalt trap.
Only good things will happen from this.
That's the path I took.
That's the exact path you took. Every square we see right now is the exact path you took.
Eli. Yeah.
Okay. Great. You get to the trapsmith.
Thank God! Well,
that tells us something.
Alrighty.
Yeah, you are now right in front of the Trapsmith.
Alright. Let's see if I attack them.
You throw down your crossbow, you pick up your club, and you slam it down, and this kobold is able to, hey, don't hurt me. You miss, unfortunately. Another feature you have, though, which I believe you can take as a bonus action, is something called Second Wind.
Yes.
And that does enable you to get hit points back.
Oh, yes, please. I need those.
All right, you get 6 HP back.
Thank God. I'm up to 15 out of my 32 now.
You are now consumed with adrenaline as you fight, and it is the alchemist's turn. And the alchemist says, how dare you break into our place of work? We just wanted to make cool stuff, and I don't like this. I am Fortude the Poison Touch, and I will show you the meaning of hurt. That's right, myself and my brother, Dave Thomas, we will take you down. And he swings his dagger at you, Mortimer.
Naturally. Okay.
Ooh, Ty goes to the defender, so he swings, and you're far too slick for that.
Sure.
Luckily,
am. He
gets a second attack, and this one lands. Ooh, baby! This one lands, doing 8 damage, slicing across your arms as you dodge and weave out of there.
Oh, no.
I'm assuming I don't have line of sight behind from the desks and where Mortimer is located.
You can go for the alchemist. If you roll too low on your attack, I will say that it hits Mortimer.
Bear that in mind.
That's. But if you would like, I mean, if you hit, you're an archer. You can.
All right, yeah, I'm gonna say that Sigmar is very confident in his archery skills, and he's gonna take the shot.
I'm not.
Do it.
9, 16?
Oh, a 16 hits the kobold. That was a very low roll, by the way. That was right. You were teetering on the edge there, Casey. Big 4 damage to the kobold here. All right. That brings us to Grinderbin. Are you still messing around with that door?
I spent last turn trying to get it unhinged. Did I manage to do that?
Absolutely. You are. Oh, sweet. That door is off its hinges. It is a door. It's still a big door, but yeah, it is off its hinges.
I'm going to say, all right, well, time for us to go on our first ride together. And I'm going to pick up the door and start walking in. I'm going to go right here.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got the door between me and our not so friends there.
Okay, yeah, we'll say that's like a shield. That's like a plus 2. Yeah,
just carrying it. It's got to be on one side. Why not make it that side?
Absolutely.
And you're using a bow, right, Casey?
Sigmar, yeah, yes.
Yeah, Sigmar's using a bow and be like, here, let me help you out with that. And I'm going to grab this little like jewel with an adhesive on the side and like stick it on your bow. Uh-huh. And your right. bow's gonna do it gets +1 to attack and +1 to damage.
Cool.
Cool.
All right, great.
And then for my reaction, I'll use my cannon to shoot.
Okay, who are you shooting?
From this angle, probably have a straighter shot at the alchemist, so I'll shoot that one.
Okay. 19. Okay, that hits.
That's better. 6.
Big 6 damage.
6 force damage and pushed backwards, which is kind of into a wall.
Sure. Well, like maybe this way.
Yeah, that works.
The alchemist is looking very hurt.
Ooh.
Is what I will say. And that brings us to this happy little kobold right here. And he goes, I don't like this. And you see that he is going to mess around with some stuff in his backpack.
I don't really like where this is going. I don't appreciate what you all are doing here, and I would like you to leave.
he did something that you can't quite see. And he is actually going to back up a little bit. And as he does that, Dabarella, you're able to take an attack on him if you'd like.
Instead of attacking, am I able to grab the backpack off of him or attempt to grab the backpack?
Sure.
The rucksack or whatever it was.
Yeah, yeah. Give me an athletics check, and he'll make an athletics check, and then we'll see who wins.
I think it's gonna be you.
Oh!
What?
Oh no! It's definitely. I cannot believe you lost that. He rolled very low. Not a one low though. You go to grab his backpack
I'm
and you're
fuming.
Your hand cramps up. You didn't have a banana earlier today, like you're very low on potassium. And yeah, you got some cramps. Ooh, sorry.
This is dumb.
So he's gonna back up while he does something, which brings us back to Mortimer.
Well, I've seen that the Kobold Alchemist is badly hurt
yes.
and reeling from an attack. So with all gentlemanly roguishness forgotten, I will do a flying leap and stab him again.
Excellent.
Because I've been injured and I'm done pissing about.
All right.
Okay, well, I guess I missed.
All right. You certainly did miss.
In that case, I would like to maybe disengage at this point.
Okay, you use your bonus action to disengage, to get away from the kobold. He cannot take an attack of opportunity on you.
Because I'm a big old coward.
That's fine. That's absolutely fair. That brings us to...
Can I still move, or was that all I can do?
Oh, yeah, you can move. Sorry.
You want to get behind this door with me?
That's a bit further than I can move in one turn. Go my maximum distance this way.
That's the path you're taking?
Yeah.
Great. I'm
running and gibbering like a tiny bald man.
No, no.
Someone else kill him. I've done my part.
All right, Dabarella, it is your turn.
I know the alchemist is weak, but I know that the others are closer, so I'm still going to go for the trapsmith. So I'm going to come. Oh, God. Is there something on the rug?
Well, soon find out.
Paranoia ensues.
I suppose the others can move. Okay, so I'll go for this one. I have a war pick. I'm going to use that.
Great. Love it. You get out.
For the
you get
love
out
of
your.
God,
like, it's like a golf club, and you take a big old swing with your war pick. You are able to golf swing him right under the jaw. The kobold is down. We're going to give him that little death marker there. And as soon as you do that, you see the other kobold, aptly named Dave Thomas, go, whoa. Okay, this just got real. How about this? I'll tell you where the scroll is, and we just all walk out of here. I get out, you get out, we get the scroll. How's that for working for you? I'll tell you where the scroll is.
All right, on one condition, you walk out first.
I can do that.
Good on you. And just head straight up those stairs and don't worry about a thing.
Oh, yeah? Okay, great. Yeah, this is great.
Okay, so where's that scroll then?
The scroll is in his pocket. It's in his coat. It's the only scroll in there. He keeps it there. He's never taken that scroll off his body since we've been down here. It's actually kind of disturbing. I don't know how he cleans himself properly with it.
Dabarella picks up his body and shakes him until the scroll falls loose from said pocket.
Falling from his pocket is a wrapped up ancient scroll glowing with green energy. As you pick it up, Dabarella, this is the scroll of necromancy. It can summon an army of the undead to your aid. Ooh.
Are we able to use this ourselves?
Well, there's a thought.
Yeah.
It is a scroll. Something you would know about scrolls is anyone can use them, but they are one-time use items.
Well, I'm thinking maybe we owe a debt to our benefactor, Miss whatever her name was. Perhaps she'd like to be the centerpiece of a huge party.
Oh, wink, wink.
I don't think Sigmar, we're getting out of here without an army of the dead or giving her the scroll, so...
Sigmar votes to sick an army on her.
Well, it sounds like unanimously in favor of that.
All right, so you all make your way out of the dungeon, Dory in tow.
Oh, the sunlight, it's glorious.
And as you ascend, you see all the archers and the soldiers are still there. And of course, Lady Fafel is there going, oh, I see you've found the scroll, have you? I suppose I'll be taking that.
I'll say, what, this scroll here, this scroll that says this, and then read out everything on the scroll.
Oh, so you read the scroll in the accursed language of the undead, and an army of the undead rise from all around you. Spirits and zombies and skeletons come. Oh, my!
And the Thumb Man!
Oh, yes!
The Thumb Man!
And
he comes back.
And Tourniquet Fast Level, everyone's favorite character, rises from the dead and heads towards Jeremy Goodsex. Now, you do have control over the undead. Does Jeremy Goodsex live or die?
Ooh, final moral choice of the mission.
I was helping out, guys. I was trying to get down her business, but my charms didn't seem to work on her. But I'm working on it, guys.
I think we should kill Jeremy Goodsex just on general principles.
I mean,
agreed.
I'm on board with not killing Jeremy Goodsex because then he's in our debt, and two, I get to keep hearing this voice from Jack.
I don't feel one way or the other about Jeremy Goodsex. I do want to roll an attack on January, though.
Ooh, absolutely. As all the,
I want to keep my promise to her.
As all the zombies rise, you see she's in disarray. The army is in disarray. You pull out your bow. You can have an attack with advantage.
Yay.
As you are centered and she is all in disarray.
20, nat 20, no less.
Ooh,
Jesus.
Fuck.
Right in the face.
How would you like to kill her? It is up to you. You get a clean shot.
It goes right between the eyes. So she sees it coming.
Yes.
Like she turns and looks dead at it as it hits her right in the brain.
Oh yes. My, where did all of these zombies? You. And falls dead. The zombies rip through the archers and the soldiers, and they are heading towards Jeremy Goodsex. A decision needs to be made, and Mortimer, you're the one that summoned them. It is your decision, once and for all.
No, please, I just, maybe if we couldn't do the zombies, I think that I could be helpful to you.
I will say hold, or whatever you need to say to make all the zombies stop. And then I will say, go on.
Well, I'm pretty good at fucking.
I will just quietly make whatever gesture makes the zombies continue.
God, no, I can't do this again!
And that concludes our one little adventure here. You win the day.
Well, I call that a profitable afternoon.
There we go. Wonderful. I'll take care of the outro later.